My name is Kara, and I've been involved in the Interfaith for a while now, and I work at my church. I do some work there, which is the Church of Scientology. I also work in social services, and I do contract work for New Era Records. So I do records analyst and work on some databases and stuff. So I was thrilled to be able to help out with the library. I know what it's like to work at a nonprofit, and we really do rely heavily on volunteers and the members to all take responsibility and put it there. So it was absolutely my pleasure to be able to do that. And now I'm hoping I can bring up my presentation. But it doesn't look like it's letting me. What's the best way do you think I should proceed here, Paula?
Go back into PowerPoint and load it back up.
So I guess as I'm doing this, I will also say that my mom is here. She's here to support me, watch my presentation. And one thing I'd like to point out too, which is I really think is important, the idea of the interfaith, is that my mom and my dad, they are Christians, and they raised me and my family as Christians, and have nothing but the most respect for the Christian faith. But when I found Scientology about 15 years ago, there was something there that just kind of, it felt right to me, and I've had nothing but support from my family to pursue my spiritual path the way I wanted to. And I know a lot of people aren't quite that fortunate that, you know, if their family member chooses a different spiritual path, but I've had nothing but love and support from my family and my friends, which has meant the world to me. It's made it really, really easy for me to embrace my religion and my family and my friends. So. Okay, so I'm going to start by telling you. So, Scientology, obviously, it gets in the media. It's a hot topic. It's an easy thing to sell. Unfortunately, there's a lot of false stuff about it and a lot of misinformation. So I'm here to tell you what the media won't tell you about Scientology. My presentation is, that's not very good, but the outline is, I'm just going to give you a little intro to L. Ron Hubbard, who's the founder of Scientology, and I'll tell you a little bit about Scientology and its basic principles. I kind of also want to talk to you how it fits in with other religions and world events, and the International Association of Scientologists and the social betterment campaigns and involvement that it is out there in the world. And so then I'll talk about Scientology in the media and open up to any questions or discussions that any of you guys might have. And that in the background is called FLAG. That's down in Florida, Clearwater, Florida. That's kind of our Vatican, our Mecca. Actually, all of these, there's the big one there is the Fort Harrison Hotel in Clearwater, and then which the church bought, and it's a hotel for people who go down there and stay. And then the next building over there is where they have a lot of the courses and the auditing and the training and the religious pursuits. And it actually takes quite a few blocks. Yeah, but that's the place to go if you're a Scientologist. And the next slide. It's thinking.
It's a slow computer.
So, well, just as I'm waiting for that, so there's just, it's a little video of L. Ron Hubbard. A lot of people think that he's, the science fiction writer. He did definitely write some science fiction. That was later in life. He's actually written way more adventures, westerns. He's written for the movies. He's had some of his screenplays in the movies. And he definitely is a science fiction writer. He's a very good science fiction writer, but it's a very small piece of what the man has accomplished. He was in the Navy. He was a pilot. He was a member of the Explorers Club. He was an engineer, a scientist. He's done so much in life. This is. Yeah, I really want to show the video because it sets the stage as to how he discovered Scientology, and it's kind of when you know him and his life, it sort of explains how the religion came about. I'm not too sure what I can.
You just might not be able to. You might have to skip the videos. I don't know why it would just be. Seems to just be crashing on the ones with the videos.
Okay. So. I do want to tell you a little bit about him. So he was one of the youngest Boy Scouts to ever reach certain ranks. He went on to study mathematics and engineering. When he was in the Navy, he got injured. He was called to war, and he got injured. And while he was there, he met many other of the soldiers and the seamen who were injured, and they just weren't responding to treatment. So he started talking to them, and through talking to them, addressed some of the more spiritual concerns, maybe mental concerns that they had, and all of a sudden, they started getting better in response to the medications. So it was through this idea that the mind over the body, the Dianetics, he created Dianetics, and wrote that book in 1950, and it went on to become the number one bestseller for a while there, and I'll talk a little bit more about Dianetics, but it was from that was the precursor to Scientology. So through that, he's like, okay, there's more to man through their mind and the spirit if it can affect the body that way. So Scientology means, it comes from the word seo Latin, which means knowing in the fullest sense of the word, and logos, which is Greek for the study of. So Scientology means knowing how to know, and the whole premise of the religion is knowing yourself, knowing others, knowing the world, knowing how to succeed in life, and just sort of knowing the universe. It is a, sorry, I'm a little thrown off now that the video didn't work. It's a 21st century religion, and it extends from certain fundamental truths. So Scientology believes that man is a spiritual being, endowed with abilities well beyond those which he normally envisions. He's not only able to solve his own problems and accomplish his own goals and gain lasting happiness, but he can achieve new states of awareness that he may never have dreamt possible. In one form or another, all great religions have held the hope of spiritual freedom, a condition free of material limitations and misery. The question has always been, however, how does one reach such a state, particularly while living amidst a frantic and often overwhelming society? So Scientology has, we have two sectors, one is training and one is auditing, and it's through these that we come to know ourselves, we come to know the universe, mankind, comes up with solutions through communications, and that help us with our insecurities, self-doubt, and despair. One of the main things in Scientology is the word Thetan, and that's from the Greek letter Theta, which is a traditional symbol for thought or life. And in Scientology, we use that as other religions would call the spirit or the soul. In Scientology,
what is that word again?
Thetan. It's the Greek word is theta. It's a letter. It's a zero with a line through it. It's the Greek word theta for thought. For thought or life. And Scientology used that word to kind of replace spirit or soul, just because those ones sort of had other connotations. And in Scientology, we believe that the Thetan is the person himself, not his body, not his name, not the physical universe. We have a body, we have a mind, we are Thetans. We are the spirit. We do not have a Thetan, we are the Thetan. So the Scientology cross here has, it's the cross with the four, and then it's got the four points here. And those all represent, in Scientology, what is called the eight dynamics. So the eight dynamics, so that's how we exist and strive to survive through life. These parts are the first dynamic, which is the urge towards existence as ourselves, our individual person. The second dynamic is through the family unit and children and creativity and creating a future. The third is through our groups. So it can be your work, it can be your church, it could be this group here, it could be the city, the country. It's how we survive as a group, and we all come together as a group. The fourth dynamic, how we survive, is through mankind. The fifth dynamic is all life, so it includes your animals and your plants as well. And the urge to survive of the physical universe. So, you know, through the physical matter, energy, space, and time. The seventh dynamic is a representation of the spiritual beings and the spiritual plane. And the eighth dynamic is what we call the supreme or the ultimate dynamic. And that is left for, that's what is bigger than us. And that can be God, it can be Allah, it could be, it's whatever you believe is your ultimate creator. Scientology doesn't define that. So that actually also makes Scientology unique in that it's one of the few religions that you can be another religion and still be a Scientologist. I know that down in the States, they actually have a large Muslim community that are also Scientologists. We don't have any dogma that would contradict your religions. I mean, you might have, your religion might contradict Scientology's, which would be fine, but Scientology opens it up that it's not exclusive to any religion. Sorry, it's got all my notes on the bottom, that's a little distracting. So Scientology as a religion. So there's three criteria. You often hear something like, it's been in the media that we're a cult or we're not a bona fide religion. Scientology is most definitely a religion. The criteria to be a religion are these three points. A belief in some ultimate reality, such as the supreme or eternal truth that transcends the here and now of the secular world. And two, religious practices directed toward understanding, attaining, or communing with the ultimate reality. And three, a community of believers who join together in pursuing this ultimate reality. So Scientology, as I had mentioned, it does believe in the ultimate reality and the eight dynamics. It also has, we do in fact have church services. So we have Sunday services, we do weddings, funerals, and naming ceremonies, as well as chaplain services, like where you would have just personal counseling, marriage counseling. Very heavily involved in our community, trying to give back to our community. Scientology also carries forward a religious tradition extending 10,000 years and embraces truths found in the oldest sacred texts of the Hindu Veda and wisdom of Buddhism. What you would have seen in the L. Ron Hubbard little biography there is that he spent decades studying cultures, world religions, and has nothing but the greatest respect for all these other religions, and he studied them intently. So our typical Sunday service, we would all get together, we'd read the Creed of the Church of Scientology. We'll have a chaplain who would give a sermon, just like typical other services. L. Ron Hubbard did, like I said, he did lots of writing, as well as he did lectures. So he would give presentations and stuff. And so sometimes we'd play a lecture. We'd pick something that he'd have to say and we would play it.
Do you sing hymns?
Sorry, we do hymns? No, we don't sing hymns, but we do have people that'll just come and sing. We do have a lot of people that like music, so we don't have, in the Christian church, we don't have that, but we love music, and so sometimes we do have some local people that play for us, and they'll play some songs, and we do group auditing. So these are a series of sort of some steps and some things you do that really kind of ground you and put you in the present moment that the chaplain would lead us through. We have announcements. We try to encourage people to get involved in their community or various other programs that are going out there where we try to encourage people to get involved in. And we have a prayer. One of the prayers that we have, I brought today, just so you can have kind of an idea, it's a prayer for total freedom. And it says, it's just a few lines here, it says, a prayer for total freedom. May the author of the universe enable all men to reach an understanding of their spiritual nature. May awareness and understanding of life expand so that all may come to know the author of the universe, and may others also reach this understanding which brings total freedom. At this time, we think of those whose liberty is threatened, of those who have suffered imprisonment for their beliefs, of those who are enslaved or martyred, and for all those who are brutalized, trapped, or attacked. We pray that human rights will be preserved so that all people may believe and worship freely, so that freedom will once again be seen in our land. Freedom from war and poverty and want, freedom to be, freedom to do, and freedom to have. freedom to use and understand man's potential, a potential that is God-given and God-like, and freedom to achieve that understanding and awareness that is total freedom. May God let it be so. So that is, we do have all the typical things you would find, that you would find in other churches, like I said. We have funerals, naming ceremonies, and weddings. Let's see, the next one is, sorry, I'm trying to cover stuff that would have already been explained by now, but so Dianetics, I had mentioned that that is what L. Ron Hubbard started off. That was sort of what started his studies and branch into religion, was this idea that when he met all these people that were in the hospitals and weren't getting better and responding to treatment, once he started talking to them and counseling them and getting them to deal with things that were spiritually troubling them or mentally troubling them, all of a sudden their body started to respond. So Dianetics is the book that he wrote in 1950, and Dianetics comes from the Greek word dia, which means through, and nous, which means mind or soul. So Dianetics is defined as what the soul is doing to the body. And there's some precise steps it's a typical auditing process where you're just asked and you just kind of handle some troubling aspects in your life. And here's a little clip from Dianetics, the Modern Science of Mental Health. The source of aberration has been found to be unsuspected sub-mind, which, complete with its own recordings, underlies what man understands to be his conscious mind. The concept of the unconscious mind is replaced in Dianetics by the discovery that the unconscious mind is the only mind which is always conscious. In Dianetics, this sub-mind is called the reactive mind. And it stores memories. It stores particular types of mental image pictures we call engrams. And they're a complete recording down to the last accurate detail of every perception present in a moment of partial or full unconsciousness. This unconsciousness could be caused by the shock of an accident, anesthetic used for an operation, pain of an injury, or the delirium of illness. During these times, the analytical mind shuts down in full or in part, and the reactive mind cuts in. An engram exists below the individual's awareness level, yet it can be activated so as to enforce its content and can cause unevaluated, unknowing, and unwanted fears, emotions, pains, and psychosomatic illnesses. The whole point of Dianetics then is to take people from the beginning to the end of that engram of, or that period of unconsciousness until it is reduced, and which there is no charge or pain associated with it anymore. The individual then becomes free of the aberrative effect of the incident and can experience enormous relief and a rise in emotional tone. So Dianetics is sort of like a way, like, you know, if you've been in a car accident and now all of a sudden maybe you're scared to drive again. That is a classic example of how these injuries, these pains, the reactive mind can stop you from doing things. All of a sudden you won't drive a car anymore because you were in a car accident once. Or a dog bit you and now all of a sudden you're scared of dogs. So Dianetics sort of helps get to the root of that and releases that fear, that upset, that part of you that's still stuck in the past when that happened, so that that doesn't hinder you in your life. So as I mentioned, as he was discovering Dianetics, more questions came out. There was more of how does this affect man? How does this affect the body, the soul? How is it all connected? And that through which Scientology evolved to. And I had another video here, which explains what auditing is. Because a lot of people ask about this. This picture up here is an e-meter. And this is what is commonly misrepresented as well. The e-meter, it's a response to physical stress. I don't want to say it's like a lie detector. It's not. But it functions a little bit the same way that it responds to stress in the body. And the auditors use it when they are auditing someone. So the video explains it so much better than I possibly can. But an auditor is trained to listen. They're not giving you things to do or say, like if you went to see maybe a psychologist, they would say, you know, here, try all these steps. An auditor is just there to listen, and they help you locate times in your life where you were maybe upset, stressed, you did something you weren't proud of. And the e-meter, by registering the stress, helps locate those thoughts and those feelings and just helps you explore them a little bit further. I don't know if I should try clicking on it. Better not. maybe I can come back at the end and see if I can get you some more information on that. But the auditing sessions, they are private, they're confidential, and it is just you and the auditor, and it is, there's precise steps, kind of like you go through grade one, grade two, grade three, you have definite curriculum. As you're doing auditing, there's still certain kind of curriculums, but it's all individualized to what the person needs and wants. So it is basically spiritual counseling. It's just the e-meter helps locate where those upsets are that need addressing. A lot of the times you think what's upsetting you isn't. So the e-meter doesn't lie. It helps you find what's really troubling you. So that's the first few times I was in auditing, I was just so, it was like this magic machine. It was like, but the stuff that my auditor has been able to help me dig out is not stuff that I thought bothered me. And then you find out, oh wow, it did, and you get it out, and you just feel this immense release. So I apologize that the video is not working, because it really does explain it much better than I possibly can. So that's one part of the church, is we have, like I said, we have our religious ceremonies, and then we have auditing, which helps you get to know yourself and take responsibility for yourself. And then there's the training aspect, and the training is tools to help you handle life. And I just put one very basic concept up on here, is the ARC triangle. So this is a very basic concept that we have in Scientology. And the ARC stands for affinity, reality, and communication. So with affinity, we mean, you know, your affection, your degrees of affection towards somebody, being around them, liking to be around them, being connected with them. Reality is sort of like, it can be your shared agreements, but it can also be knowing what the other person is important to them. Like, you can have disagreements there, but you know what's real to them. Politics might be a bit of a good one. You have different politics. Or actually, like, I really like to use this group as an example of the ARC triangle. So we all have maybe different religious faiths, but we're learning about each other's reality, so we can understand each other's reality. And then communication is just obviously that, being able to talk and share and explore ideas. And when you have high affinity, high reality, high communication, you have understanding. And that's basically, in the simplest of terms in Scientology, that's the universal solvent for everything. And I really do, again, I think this group is a great example of that. Because we come to these events and we get to know each other, so we start to build this affinity for each other. We start to have this affection and get to know people. We learn about each other's religions. And I know there's a lot of work that the Interfaith does with human rights, so there's a reality there that we all have. And we communicate it. For example, I'm being given the opportunity to talk to you about my religion, and you guys are here willing to listen to it. So when you have these three, we have understanding for each other. And I've always felt it's important for what the Interfaith is doing. I've always felt it's been important. But until I've gotten involved and been able to have this communication with other people of other religions and the reality and the affinity, now I have this humanity behind my philosophy. So. This ARC triangle is very fundamental in Scientology. It also works the opposite way. It can get smaller and smaller. You can see what's happening in the States. You have Trump and Clinton supporters, or you have, and I mean, this is in its most simplest form, but you have people who won't even communicate with people because they have different, you know, philosophies, and now their affection for each other. I literally have seen marriages, I've seen stories where marriages have broken up over this. You know, and then the communication starts getting ridiculous. It's very black and white. If you're a Hillary supporter, you're this. If you're a Trump supporter, you're this. And people are losing sight because they're not communicating. They're not. So this understanding is going down, down, down. So this is just like a little small sampling of some of the stuff we study in Scientology that help give us the tools to survive in life and to flourish and prosper. These are some pictures of the church, some churches around the world. Edmonton's looks nothing like this. My sister saw a book lying around of all these churches that are like, that we call them ideal churches, ideal orgs that we fundraise and, you know, that we have around the world. And my sister's like, well, Scientology would be a lot bigger if you had one of those like here in Edmonton. I'm like, we're trying. But these ones are, like this blue one up here is in LA. This is the one in St. Hill. We're in England, where Hubbard spent decades towards the end of his life too, and it's a castle. He actually bought a castle and converted it. Love to get over there. And I'm going to be honest, I'm not sure where these ones are from. I don't remember. We have quite a few churches around the world, but like I said, we're in a bit of a industrial strip mall. So I want to show you what we look like around the world. So those are what some of the churches look like. This, I would like to share with you some things that that L. Ron Hubbard has talked about Scientology's views in regards to other religions. Like I said, he studied many religions. He was in East. He was in. He spent a good portion of the time in the East and out in Asia and learned about those religions. And he's just studied and he's very interested in anthropology and stuff. And some these are some of his direct quotes. He wrote that Scientology shares the goals set for man by Christ, which are wisdom, good health, and immortality. In Religious Influence in Society, Role of the Volunteer Minister, L. Ron Hubbard states, the great religious civilizing force of the past, Buddhism, Judaism, Christianity, and others, have all emphasized differentiation of good from evil and higher ethical values. In the hope of man, this is a lecture that he did in 1955, Mr. Hubbard states that he honors the great spiritual leaders of the past, not of modern times, but of the past, since these people have handed along enough tradition to make us aware of the fact that there was a spiritual side to man. These great spiritual leaders have been hanged, reviled, and misinterpreted, badly quoted, have not been at all comprehended, but nevertheless, they are the hands through which a torch has been handed forward through the centuries so that we could culminate with a greater ability for man and some hope for his future. All these people were saying something that was much more important than there is a spiritual side to life. They were saying there is hope. They can come to you and they can tell you that all is lost and that you are dead, you're trapped, and there's no hope for you. They can come to you and say this, but this is not true. There's hope. You do go on living. This life is not all there is. There is some future life in which you can do better, succeed more worthily than you have. That is all these men said. Enormous amount of what we call religion in this Western Hemisphere today was given to the Western Hemisphere directly by Gautama Buddha. It was filtered through the Middle East. Love thy neighbor was one of the first lessons he taught, and it is that lesson which we have received from the Middle East. But what I am telling you is that these people handed on a torch of wisdom, of information, generation to generation. It was handed along geographical routes, and one of those geographical routes was the Middle East. And one of the people who handed on was a man named Moses. And again, it was handed on to a man named Christ. And he handed it on, and even the Arab nations benefited from this through their own prophet Muhammad. And these men I consider great spiritual leaders because they gave to man, on down through the years, the hope that life could go on, that there was a spiritual side to existence, that the business of barter and gain was not all there was to life. Furthermore, in The Way to Happiness, which is not a religious work, but is a secular sort of moral code, Mr. Hubbard provided a number of practical guidelines to live by. One of the precepts in the book is respect the religious beliefs of others. Tolerance is a good cornerstone on which to build human relationships. When one views the slaughter and suffering caused by religious intolerance down all the history of man and into modern times, one can see that intolerance is a very non-survival activity. Religious tolerance does not mean one cannot express his own beliefs. It does mean that seeking to undermine or attack the religious faith and beliefs of another has always been a short road to trouble. So, like I said, in Scientology there is, great respect for religion in general, and because of the training and the auditing, it is open to all religions. But like I said, maybe not every religion might not embrace Scientology, but definitely Scientology welcomes all religions. Another video that doesn't come up. So the International Association of Scientologists, this is a worldwide group, so it's sort of like our foundation. Scientologists become members, we donate money to it, and then the International Association of Scientologists fund our social betterment programs. This is probably what makes me the proudest to be a Scientologist. It's a nice video. I get teary-eyed when I watch it, so maybe it's good it's not working. I mean, it becomes a bit of a blubbering mess. But some of the things it does is we fund Drug-Free World. So it's, Drug-Free World empowers youth and adults with information about drugs so they can make informed decisions and quit drugs. So we get into the schools and we hand out, we have books on all the different drugs and just educate the kids. It's a really good program. It's worldwide. Obviously bigger in some areas. LA has had some great success with it, Toronto as well. Basically the belief is instead of, talking down to kids, let's just give them the facts, let them know how dangerous they are, and they make their own decisions. So we fund that, and these are secular. They're available for everybody, and they have no connection to Scientology, despite what people might say about. There's nothing mentioned about Scientology in it at all. The other one is the Citizens Commission on Human Rights. So this was actually started by, he wasn't a Scientologist, Thomas Sass was a psychologist, and it was formed in 1969. And basically it's a watchdog to ensure that people who have mental illness or mental health problems are not losing their human rights because of such. You know, you can be committed involuntarily, you can be forced to have medications. Certain places in the world, you know, they're fighting to give kids electroshock therapy. You know, you can't decline it in certain places. So Citizens Commission on Human Rights is really trying to safeguard people's rights when they have mental health problems. Another one we do is United for Human Rights and Youth for Human Rights. So we do have a youth program and then just a general Unite for Human Rights. And again, it's a campaign just to bring awareness on universal human rights. It works with the UN. And we usually send young delegates there, and they get involved. And we have lots of contests and campaigns and such to try to get the youth to, you know, our next generation. You know, they know their human rights, and they know that, guess what? These human rights I have, you have, you have, you have, you have. We all have the same human rights. And encouraging them to speak up when they see those being abused, whether it's, you know, theirs being abused or somebody else's, that they take up and stand up and take responsibility for that. We also fund the volunteer ministers. So this, I think, is in Haiti. This one's 9/11. It's sort of like the Red Cross. It's a group of people that we go to disaster sites and we help the rescue teams. We help people who've been displaced. We help rebuild the hospitals, the houses, right there. It says volunteer ministers have become a recognized global force, serving at 200 disaster sites in the wake of earthquakes, tsunamis, floods and fires, hurricanes and typhoons. And let me tell you, with the Fort Mac fires, right, I was getting calls from LA, you guys got to organize the volunteer ministers. I'm like, I can't. Alberta is, everybody is so on it. they're overburdened with volunteers, which was actually amazing to see how we have the infrastructure and we have the community here that when that happened, just how everybody stepped up. But unfortunately, like in Haiti and certain other places, they just did not have that. So we do have our own links with Red Cross. They go and they help. And some of the stuff we learn in Scientology too is like assists, so like things that we do when somebody's hurt or injured or scared or upset, just some basic things we can do to help them through that. And so we also offer that. I myself haven't gone to any of these. I don't quite have the lifestyle that would allow me to do that, but we did have some people from our parish went down when Louisiana had the floods, and they were down there for quite a few months working down in there. And so of course that takes money, so you know, we fund that as well. And we do the Way to Happiness campaign. So this is a book, and I brought some if anybody's interested. Like I said, they're non-religious, but they're little booklets, 21 precepts that just basically encourage us to have respect for a fellow man, and we give those out. They've had great success. Actually, I had the honor of meeting him. I'm gonna mess up his name, but he was from Colombia, and he was head of the military, the police, and I actually met him. And they implemented this campaign throughout all of Colombia to try to fight the crime. And through this and other partnerships, it got dialogue going, and I'm not saying it's all because of this, but actually if you look at the Colombian crime statistics, the national crime, and they'll go maybe 5 years to now, it's dropped dramatically. Not because of this, but this did certainly open the... I don't want to downplay what this has done, but I'm not saying it's the only thing. But it certainly opened the platform for people to get together and have these ideas and discuss them and come up with some solutions on how they can combat it. So the Way to Happiness is another one that we're quite pleased of. It's actually a program we use too in the prisons to help inmates restore their self-respect and start with rehabilitation. Narconon is a drug rehabilitation program that we have for addicts. They can go in, they can get clean, and help identify what made them turn to drugs in the first place.
So is that the same thing as Narcotics Anonymous, or that's...
No, well, that this one is an actual facility.
Oh.
Like, you go into it and you do a purification, and you do some classes and some auditing. Yeah. And that's open, again, you don't have to be a Scientologist for that, that's open for me. Applied Scholastics is learning programs. It's based on some study tools that L. Ron Hubbard developed. We have literacy programs, after school cares, we have schools. And it's basically used to just help people, help kids learn, get the literacy rate up, help them understand while they're in school. Criminon, as I said, so I actually I did do this for 2.5 years. So you're anonymous and you write to the inmates and you give them lessons that are based on the way to happiness and you mark them and you write to them. And I had some out in Bowdoin and some in the Max. And so I don't know what they're in there for. It wasn't, not something you typically ask. You're supposed to just grade the, you know, papers and stuff. But it was, I'm thinking if you're in the Max, you're in there for something pretty big. And he did the Way to Happiness, and then there's some other courses that they can do correspondence. And I graded them and worked with them on it. And it's amazing to see somebody start feeling good about themselves, taking responsibility for what they did, and wanting to make things right. We had some trouble. Some people were trying to get this in the prison systems. They're like, well, they're prisoners. You know, we're not gonna. But you're like, they're coming out. They're going to come out one way or the other. Do we want them rehabilitated and contributing members, or do we want them more upset, more angry, and more likely to commit more crime? I think the recidivism rate is something like 85%, you know, so we need to stop that. So we do fund this Criminon. And those are some of the things that we do. The other thing that the International Association of Scientologists does is we fight for religious freedoms. I'm floored at how many, since I've joined this group, like, it's opened up my eyes to how much persecution different religions have in, you know, throughout the world. Like, you know, I think, oh, well, Christians, that's a pretty good one to be. No, over here, Christians are persecuted. Over here, Muslims are. It's worldwide. And one thing, and Scientologists, we're another one. And one thing that I'm very proud of that we do is we fight for religious rights. We absolutely do. One of the ones that I'm the most proud of, it's quite recent, it was in Belgium. So back in the 90s, it was kind of a worldwide climate where people were attacking newer religions or what they decided were sects, were dangerous cults, and they were kind of put on these lists that we gotta watch them and the government had to watch them. And so in Belgium in the 1990s, there was an anti-sect phobia, and especially in France, and it trickled into Belgium. And there was a parliamentary commission of inquiry that was created to investigate possible dangers coming from new religions, movements, and groups that they labeled as harmful sects. So they, in 1997, this group issued and disseminated to the media, the police, all the I don't want to say Interpol, but you know, like the government in Belgium, and it was used as a blacklist. It had 189 religious groups on there, identified and labeled as potentially dangerous. And this list was used for almost 20 years to harass, limit, target, persecute, arrest all anybody involved in these groups. So absolutely, Scientology was on the list. Some of the other ones that you'd be surprised here, I don't have the full list, obviously, but there's a handful here. The Young Women's Christian Association, the Amish, the Hasidic Jews, the Baha'is, Seventh-day Adventists, Mormons, and Pentecostals, just to name a few. If you were some of these religions and some of the other 180, you were targeted. 20 years. And I don't know how badly the other religions were harassed. I don't have information on that. I'm assuming it was just as bad as we were out there. But there was a major investigation was launched into Scientology. The chief investigator, he attended all these anti-religious conferences and spent 18 years seizing our documents, arresting church members, doing whatever they could to shut us down. And there was set up a crime, which I think we were convicted of, the e-meter that I talked about, illegally using a medical device or something along those lines, right? So with the church, backed by the IAS, which is, you know, the Scientologists around the world giving money to this foundation, they were able to fund, to fight back, obviously, and spent the time fighting back its right to exist in the courts and defending itself as well as parishioners from criminal charges. In the beginning of 2016, the 69th trial chamber of the Brussels Criminal Court dismissed all charges, and the judge stated that there was serious and irremediable breach of the right to a fair trial. So this Parliamentary Commission of Inquiry has been shut down, and this court case has opened up and set a precedent for all those other religions in Belgium. And what's really key about that is that's where the European nation, where they meet, is right in Belgium. Key demographic to opening up religious freedom for everyone through Europe. So it's things like that you know, really make me proud to be an International Association of Scientologists member, and that's some of the things that we fund. Another video, just so we can meet some Scientologists. And then I was going to talk a little bit about the media. So obviously Scientology is not the only ones. A lot of religions, right? Like I was, we kind of look at the history of the media. I think you can go back, go back to the Inquisition. All you had to do was call anybody a witch, anybody a Wiccan or a witch, you could do that. And through propaganda, they were tried, they weren't even tried, they were killed. Recently, I mean, I don't know if any of you guys have seen the horrendous propaganda that was about the Jews prior to World War II. In the papers and the little flyers given out. The most disgusting stuff you've ever seen in your life. But what does that do? That serves to stir people up, make us dehumanize each other, say they're evil. And then absolutely you can use religious, you can attack that religion because they're not a religion, they're this group. So this happened throughout. I was at the Festival of Faiths, and the Muslims had to actually had to have material there that told people how they weren't terrorists. And this is how bad it has come. Mm-hmm. And media has now become this thing, who gets the most clicks, most likes, most shares. It's not even about facts. You put it out there and then you fact check later. And it's been damaging, and it creates this, the art of war they talk about, right? Divide and conquer. You know, if you can get these guys fighting, you can do whatever you want over here, right? So the media has been damaging to religions, absolutely has. And so one of the, and I wanted to click on this, but now I'm worried it's not going to come up. But Scientology has, we've made a book, and it's called What is the Freedom of Religion? And it's for any religion, and I'm really hoping, I want to get a hard copy to donate. To the Interfaith, but it's all about what your rights are. It talks about the United Nations and your rights to not be discriminated against and to have your beliefs. And at the end of the book, there is a whole section on trying to put ethics in journalism and saying, absolutely, you can report on Scientology, but why are you always going to the people who haven't been in Scientology for 20 years, who are getting paid to bash it? Why are you not going to the other side of it? Why are you not respecting other people's sacred texts? Why are you doing it to promote hatred instead of understanding? And there's this whole idea about putting ethics in journalism, which is something I'm starting to really grow interested in, and I'm hoping maybe that's something as a group down the line we could have more discussions about or start a coalition where we're holding some of these journalists accountable for, are you spreading hate or are you spreading, are you trying to problem solve in this ARC triangle and the understanding? So yeah, I'm trying to get my hands on this book, but it's you can download it, and there's a whole section on ethics in journalism. And that kind of brings me, I do want to bring up something that, there's a lot of stories that are out there on Scientology. I was trying to explain this to a friend. They're getting paid. First of all, you're getting paid. You're gonna pay me money, I'll tell you what you wanna hear. If you can, you find something that is gonna sell, and you know, Scientology is a cult. Yeah, this is my favorite. If there's any story about Scientology and there's a picture of Tom Cruise on it, it's probably sensationalized and it's probably all garbage. most of what's being put out there are the same 8-9 Scientologists. They've been kicked out of Scientology, and most of them have criminal records. And they're spitting out the same stuff and they're getting paid. One member, who's one of the most vocal, is actually on a panel in Germany, which is sort of like the panel I was talking about in Belgium that is set to shut down religions. And he's paid $100,000 a year by the German government to attack Scientology. And I'm sure it's not, you know, there's other religions, I'm sure, that they recruit these apostates. people leave a religion. When they leave a religion, 9 times out of 10, they don't have anything nice to say about it. I have lots of great things to say about Christianity. I would never go and attack it. Some people who leave for other reasons, and so can they be trusted to have a fair assessment? A lot of the times when Scientology is being promoted, they don't show the other side. They won't talk to us. They just want to get the people who've left or who've got beef or who want to attack it. And and I was going to say, as an example, if somebody wanted to make, a documentary about, I think somebody was going to make a documentary on you. Think of maybe the people who might be upset with you in your past, ex-boyfriends, ex-girlfriends, maybe people you had to fire from a job, maybe a neighbor who you had to call by long because they nearly turned their dandelions. Yeah, right? And then think, I'm going to make a movie about you, and those are the people I'm going to go to, and I'm going to pay them to say whatever I want them to say. And I'm not going to go to the people who love you. I'm not going to go to your friends. I'm not going to go to the people who have the good things to say. Am I giving a balanced view of it? Probably not. I'd be scared to death if somebody did a video like that on me, because you can find some ex-boyfriends and some ex-employees and stuff that I'm sure are not ex-roommates who are probably not thrilled with me. But I also have a lot of people who love me. That, you know, if you're going to do a fair assessment on me or my religion, I would like that there's some respect on this, on our sacred text. There's some respect on the fact that you're interviewing people who are getting paid to attack it. Why are you getting paid to attack something that you were involved in? If you don't like it, leave. But to attack it, when I know we do a lot of good in this world. I know we do. And I'm not saying that everybody's... I know we're not the only religion that does that. I absolutely know that. So anyways, that's just some of the things I wanted to say about that. And I did have some... See, is that the right time? One? Maybe it's good the videos didn't work. I do have, if anybody's looking for... what's the church just said? There's some websites there called freedommag.org, Going Clear, and Leah Remini, Aftermath. And that actually has official statements. And she's on camera talking about how wonderful Scientology is and how people who are ex-Scientologists that attack it need to get a life. And it's quite interesting. Now she's making money off of attacking it. But I thought I had another one here where I had some resources. Yeah. These videos like that I wanted to show you, or if you had any questions about them, if you go to Scientology.org, it's got links to all of those ones. But it shows there's some basic training stuff that we do that's free. You can see what we learn, and there's the auditing video. The Freedom Magazine is sort of like a worldwide magazine that we do on all issues, human rights issues, and L. Ron Hubbard.org, Scientology Religion. And then I did bring a few books just if anybody was interested in learning more about it. There's just some there, and a couple of our human rights books. These are the ones we do for the Youth for Human Rights. It's got a page on each of the 30 rights. And I brought some of our Way to Happiness books, and a few of these, the Church of Scientology. This is Voice for Humanity. So this is our fourth dynamic campaign. Anybody's interested in learning a little bit more about what we do, but yeah, I guess that's basically it. If anybody has any questions, I apologize for the technical difficulties. I'm a little flustered all over the place because I had it all prepared a certain way, but it's going to be a little bit more on the fly. But did anybody have any questions or comments? Or
I have a question about the mental health practice.
Yeah.
With that. So when those have been developed over the years, have they been developed according to sort of ethical standards, peer-reviewed work in peer-reviewed journals? Like, what sort of rigor have they been put through, the practices being put through, to determine the effectiveness and whether or not they're constructive and healthy?
Are you talking about the Dianetics? Or
I
the...
suppose so, yes. Yeah.
Okay, because we don't, Scientology doesn't tackle mental illness. It addresses spiritual.
You use the word counseling, spiritual counseling.
Spiritual counseling, yes, yeah. Not mental illness, not like
it's
psychiatric.
Mental health, though, right?
Yeah, I would say that even talking to your friends is mental health. Like, you have to have someone you can talk to. We don't give medicine, we don't diagnose, we do nothing of that sort. And in fact, an auditor, like I said, listens. We do not give, I should say, I'm not an auditor. does not practice in telling anybody any sort of medical treatment in that regard. It would be very similar to any other, you know, I don't know what all other chaplains do in other religions, but I know that when I was involved in the Catholic Church, I did have a Catholic priest that I could go confess to, I could talk to, you know, I could get my troubles off. And he wouldn't come back and say, oh, you know, you need to take this or you need to do this. And our church is the exact same way. We don't deal in mental health.
So it's not spiritual counseling then? It's not, counseling's not involved?
Well, it depends how you define counseling.
Yeah,
like we give, it would be similar to like in spiritual counseling, and it's different for everybody that goes to it. But if I went to my chaplain and me and my husband were fighting and we needed some marriage counseling, they would say, okay, well, here's some steps you can do, or here's, you know, according to our text, you guys would sit down, you would talk, you would do this. Same sort of thing. If I was really upset with something or I was angry with somebody, we have things that are similar to what the Catholic Church does in confessionals, where we would say, okay, well, here are some things that I did to this person that I'm not feeling good about, and you just get it off your chest. But when you're talking about counseling, like coming over into, like,
because you used the term spiritual counseling, that's what I was.
Oh, so yes, no, it's not mental health. I meant more of like what a Catholic priest would do, or I'm assuming what a rabbi would do. Just someone to go talk to and help you deal with some strategies in life,
okay.
Not a mental health program,
okay.
Per se.
Okay.
Yeah, I was using counseling more in that term, but definitely we're not mental health experts. And like I said, we believe we're thetans and we have a body and a mind. So we don't really address mental health,
okay.
If that makes much sense.
Okay, thanks for the clarification.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry if I was, that was, I should have clarified the word counseling because I know it kind of means so much. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But the Dianetics was actually back in the 50s, from what I know, it was opened up a lot. In the end, I know that Hubbard went to psychologists, psychiatrists, and he was promoting it. I'm not too sure about all the peer review that went in the Dianetics. That was more, again, that was more of talking about, he just noticed that when you talked about, like he studied Freud and some of the people that came after him, but he knew that when you talked about traumatic stuff, it seemed to lessen the burden. And that was kind of really beyond, that was about it. There was nothing beyond that where it got into the mental health piece of things, if that makes much sense. Yeah, yeah.
Some time ago, and I don't have the detail fresh in my mind anymore, but it was an issue about the governance of the Scientology community, who were obliging this person to remove themselves completely, and she was not allowed to go to a Scientology church or to claim that she was a Scientologist, and it was a church ruling, and I just don't know. So when you sign up to be a Scientologist, you sign a piece of paper to say that you believe certain things or you practice certain things? Is that how you become one?
No, I'm not too sure what happened there, what you're talking about there. But one thing that is involved is, and it's very much like any religion in that there's kind of a code of conduct. Like, you don't do stuff illegal. You don't do all this kind of stuff. And if you do, the church just kind of says, okay, well, you know, you've done this, or we've done this, let's get that handled, let's get you cleaned up. And if people don't want to, or they start attacking other people, then like any church, you can excommunicate them. The Scientology Church, though, always has the door open and says you're always welcome back if you can, you know, do reparation for the damage you've done. So I don't know that exact incident,
okay, well, I don't
but but I mean, I could tell you, like, people who are overtly attacking us and telling us, you know, spreading lies about us and attacking us, why would we want them back? Like, it would be like any other church. If you're being attacked, you're not going to say, oh, come on back in and continue to attack us and harass us and hurt us. So I don't know that individual case, but that's the general way that we're run. You're more than welcome to, you know, come and be a part of us, but if you continue to attack us and, you know.
But you have to sign on a dotted line.
To be a Scientologist? No, absolutely not. To become a Scientologist, you have to sign on the dotted line? No. You do sign that you're, that when you take, if you're auditing somebody else, that's privileged information, you're not sharing that. Like, you do sign things like that, saying, listen, like, if, because you can train to be an auditor, right? And then you do have an auditor, or you are a chaplain, and so you're bound by the same confidentiality that priests or rabbis or everybody else is. So you do sign off that I'm not going to break the trust of this person and that these are private, and you, but you don't, you don't have to sign a document that says I'm for hereby ever a Scientologist. And so I'm not sure, you know, exactly, but absolutely not. No, people are free to leave or come or go. We just ask that it's respected, right?
So, like, you don't have a list of people who are members of the Scientology community?
Like a list of, like our parishioners,
yeah.
You mean? Or?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, we have people who, like, if you sign up for courses or you come to our Sunday services, we know who you are, and we invite you to events and that sort of thing. Yeah, yeah. We do, I mean, we definitely have, but you don't have to sign anything. It's like if you come in to a Sunday service or you sign up for a train, like some of our training or our courses, or you sign up for a mail list or something like that, then yeah, then we would have your information and we would continue. But it'd be like anything, it'd be like the Interfaith. We'd have it and we'd use it to invite you to come out or participate or, you know, to attend some events or things like that. But it's not like you have to sign up to be a Scientologist, and once you sign, you can't leave, or you have to leave, and nothing like that. It's
okay.
More like, yeah, like we want to have a mailing list or encourage people to be involved, and that type of thing. Is that sort of, yeah.
In regard to auditors, what does the training involve, and who does the training, and is it kind of an elite thing to do, or?
No, actually, the videos explained it so good, but it's actually something that all Scientologists are encouraged to do, and there's different levels. So it's like I was kind of saying, grade school. You know, like you get this bit of training, and you can do this little bit of auditing, and you can do better, and you get better, and you get better. So it's not like it's a 6-month course, and now all of a sudden, like it's when you're doing some of the higher level auditing, you're talking years and years of training.
Done through the organization.
Right. Yes. You're learning certain.
And would they be psychologists or psychiatrists?
No.
Not necessarily. So.
No. Again, it's just the auditor is just someone who listens. So it's very much like just asking somebody a question, and then they talk. They just do it all. The auditor, what you're kind of getting trained to do is you're getting trained to listen, to look for indicators from the person's upset, to work the e-meter, and then a list of various questions you ask. You're not giving any medical advice. And actually, people will often audit each other. It's called twinning in Scientology, and you learn a certain amount, and you audit each other. And it's not, like I said, it's not counseling. People really sort of think that the auditors are doing some sort of mental health thing, and it's not. It's you're trained to use this e-meter and just help people locate stress, and then basically get them to talk about it, and then they feel relief. So you do go through training. I'm not really trained very much in auditing. I don't do it. I've got like this little low grade. I don't use the e-meter. I'm just the very, very basic of auditing training. So I couldn't give you my reality on it. But I have received it. I have received the auditing. Yeah.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Kara. That was very, very interesting. Now, I suppose if people want to see these videos, they can probably just go online and find them.
Yeah. If you go to Scientology.org, there's a really good video about the auditing, and it would probably, there might be some questions, there is some questions on there too about how it's different from psychology and psychiatry. Would definitely answer that question.
Uh-huh.
And it links to everything. It links to all our campaigns. It links to the videos about L. Ron Hubbard, frequently asked questions,
mm-hmm.
Other religious views. It would definitely, it could give you more on the auditing and the mental piece of it.
Yeah.
Much more clarified than I could personally answer.
Thank you.